It's World AIDS Day, and for the capital, a poignant anniversary, because 2021 marks 40 years since the first person died of AIDS-related complications in London. Tonight, a vigil is being held in Soho, where we can join Paul Murphy-Kasp. Paul.
Good evening, Alice. Yes, you join me in Soho Square, usually a bustling hub of the gay community, but tonight people are stopping to pause and reflect on those who've died of AIDS here over the last 40 years. Now, there's still a lot of stigma and misinformation around HIV and AIDS, and one of the messages that people want to give out tonight is that testing is important and people should know their status, but also that undetectable means untransmissible, which effectively means if you're on effective HIV medication, you cannot pass on the virus. Now, around 12,000 people have died in London of AIDS over the last 40 years and of AIDS-related illnesses, and there is still a lot of stigma and homophobia around it. We've been speaking to some of the people who are around during the time, including an MP who was the first to come out in Parliament and also the world's first to announce his HIV status publicly. A word of warning that this report does contain some upsetting stories.
Being gay was not being part of the mainstream at all.
You were either out and risked being completely out and at risk of violence, or you hid it completely.
By the end of the decade, 4,000 people in Britain will have died of AIDS.
My first experience of it was through my partner's illness and then death, and my own illness. Terry died, and then other people just started dropping, like flies. People died very quickly in those days. You would say to somebody, oh, how's Joe? I haven't seen him for a couple of weeks. Oh, he's dead. But I saw him 2 weeks ago. He was absolutely fine. And that started to be really not unusual.
We simply didn't know enough about this thing. And there was quite a lot of fear. I was diagnosed very early in 1987. I immediately assumed it was a death sentence. I thought I was going to die in 6 months' time.
I was expecting to be dead within 12 months. And I lived with that for years.
How do you cope with that?
Yeah. You have to sort of get up in the morning and do what you can to make life a bit better. If you're still alive at the end of the day, great.
In London on Monday, Britain's first purpose-built ward for the treatment of AIDS will be opened at the Middlesex Hospital.
Broderick Ward was the first dedicated HIV unit in the UK. And I did find when I arrived that the team spirit was extraordinary.
The ward can take 12 patients.
They were my age at that stage. They were young men. They were reading the same books. They were going to the same shows. They were actually, of course, they were often writing the shows. We had, without doubt, the best Christmas parties and so on. That's partly because of our clientele. And then there would always come a time when people would sort of turn their face to the wall. A patient in particular, I remember, who just decided enough. And he just turned himself so that he was sort of facing the wall as we went round on the rounds, and then gently died the next day or the day after.
Over those years, you lost people. And then you made new friends. And when you're younger, it's easier to do. And then they died. You'd think, okay, I'm starting to lose even the memories of my friends, because too many people are dying. And I started writing them down, starting with Terry. By the time I got to 35, I thought, I can't do this anymore. More died, but I couldn't face tracking them, their names.
If you got diagnosed with HIV, you were facing two diseases. You were facing the virus itself, but you were also facing this whole apparatus of shame and denigration that came on top of that.
There were many of our patients who hadn't come out to their parents about their sexuality. You had parents who were trying to come to terms not only with the fact that their son was dying, but also that he was gay and that he had a partner whom he loved.
Today, Nelson Mandela looked more frail and pained than ever.
When we got to 2005, the trigger was Nelson Mandela.
His eldest son died of AIDS. Mandela made that public.
Mandela made this very powerful speech saying,
"We must not hide the cause of death of our respective families, because that is the only way in which we can make people understand that even HIV is an ordinary illness."
I just decided, yep, this is the moment to do it. And I phoned up the Sunday Times and I said, I want to go public with this. I can remember thinking, oh my God, what have I done? On the Monday, I walked into my parliamentary office and there was a little note on my desk, "Please ring Mr. Mandela." The phone was picked up by Nelson Mandela, and he said, "I just want to say thank you and well done." And I have to say that sort of made it worth it.
I would hope that the 40 years that we've been through could be used to encourage people to have compassion towards others.
You can have HIV and you can lead an incredibly worthwhile life. And knowing that about yourself is incredibly important.